I'm going to tell you how we use FME in our Danish municipality. A quick view of what I will tell you about. First, a little of my background. Then some about our scheduled FME jobs, our ad hoc FME usage, and when I don't use FME. And then a little project about DEM manipulation. And last, a little pet project about remote sensing. This is the most interesting part, at least from my point of view. Yes, as has already been told, my name is Tune Nielsen Poulsen. I've been employed at Silkeborg Municipality for 5 years, using FME most of the time. Silkeborg Municipality is 860 square kilometers, 90,000 inhabitants, and we are around 7 persons working with GIS, where 4 of those use FME. And in Denmark, that is a quite large GIS department compared to the size of the municipality. Just to show you where Denmark is, if you don't know, up here in the northern end of Europe, we always hear that some, especially Americans, think that Denmark is the capital of Sweden, but it's not. It's I don't know if any Americans believe that, but that's what we hear. So just to show you that we are a country. And if we look at Denmark, Silkeborg is right in the middle of the peninsula Jutland. The capital is Copenhagen, over on the right. So we are the 10th biggest city. On to our scheduled FME jobs. I guess this is where we get the most value of our FME license. These are the most crucial things. But from my point of view as a developer, it's not the most interesting things. It's the daily chores. We download a lot of data from VFS with FME. Sometimes it's just downloading a whole data set and saving it to our database, or sometimes it's more advanced than that. We download our cadastral map from the Danish mapping agency. They have this weird maximum of 5,000 objects that you can download at one time. And since our cadastral map is a few hundred thousand objects, we have to do a little trick. So I use the workspace runner. It's one of my very good friends among the transformers. I've made this text file that has a grid. So the workspace runner reads my grid and download each square of data. And I have manually made these grids so they don't contain more than 5,000 objects. It's ridiculous for a normal download job. But it's necessary, and it's probably, you know, cadastral data is very important. Everybody uses them, more or less. So this text file is many hours of work. Because in the rural areas, they are 4 times 4 kilometers, but in the city, it's 250 times 250 meters. So it has taken a lot of time to get it right. Of course, the VFS connections, we also use them directly as they're meant to be in our web-GIS, but some of them aren't. If they are not fast enough to show streamed, then we need to download them. And if we want to work more with data, it's usually best to have the data in your own database. So we download most of the data each night, some each Sunday, that depends. We also do some downloading of data from FTP. And I recently made a Python script to do this, so I don't have to remember each week to go to my FTP client and download the data and run the workspace, but now it just runs weekly, downloading the data and putting it in the database. I don't really know any Python, but I found some nice templates on the web and copy-pasted them right together. It was a not knowing very much Python, it was a cool feeling making some. We also have a lot of users that need CAD data, and I'm primarily a GIS user, so I find the CAD users very frustrating because they have all sorts of different needs. Most of them complain when I give them a non-colored file, so I have spent a lot of time coloring files with FME, and that's not as easy as it sounds. And also, I deliver them with FTP. Our ad hoc FME usage is very large. I have come to a point with FME where I try with FME first, but if I realize it might be might take shorter time with my desktop GIS, we use Geomedia, then I use that. But I usually start with FME because it's such a fun program to use. You probably know the feeling. It could be converting to and from CAD. We have a supplier of data that's our utility company. They have all these crazy CAD drawings that we get from them. So we need to do a validation, repair damaged geometry, or just weird CAD geometry. Sometimes it has to be reprojected, or if it's too DGN, I'm converting, I need the DGN styler or the DVG styler. It could also be joining a few tables for a quick analysis. It could be joining our registry of citizens with our buildings registry and say how many people live how many people have their homes heated by gas, or how many people live with brick roofs, or anything like that. We do a lot of joining the big registries. Denmark is a country where you have a lot of info about your citizens and their buildings, so we have a lot of interesting data. So FME is very handy for joining a couple of tables or aggregating them to some polygons, showing what the registries contain. It's a very it's a fun task because you can make very very interesting maps, just showing where people live or how they are. Do they own their house? Do they rent their house? All these sorts of information. Oh yeah, and then Feature Merger is my favorite transformer for that. I use it quite a lot. It's very flexible. I also do some import. Well, I often usually import data to our SQL server, as I already mentioned a bit. One of my newest tricks is when I get this crazy CAD drawing, I clip all polar lines to single lines because, well, a single line cannot have any geometry errors. There might be, well, you get a lot of objects, but they're very simple and they can't contain any geometry errors. So that's my newest trick when I get this crazy CAD file. When do I not use FME? I had a similar presentation at the World Tour where I said that FME could not be used for layout. I was later corrected, so I changed the next line to haven't explored mapping rasterizer yet. I look forward to it because we spend a lot of time doing cartography. And well, many people do that, and it's a fun work, but it's not fun when you lose your setup or the data changes and you have to redo what you already made. So I hope the mapping rasterizer can help me with that. Manual editing of geometry. Sometimes I find 500 objects in a data set that I have to edit because, well, I could not find a way in FME to make them valid or need to update them or something. And here I don't use FME either, but it's not made for that, I think. At least Geomedia is a lot better than going from object one, doing the edit, to object two, doing the edit, all these tedious tasks. Then I go to Geomedia. Also, quick checks of autophoto and data. Well, we use our web-GIS. For example, checking the newest autophoto. Is the quality okay, or does it contain the newest development in the city? Then FME is not the fastest anymore. But that's almost the only situations I don't use FME. Then for our DEM manipulation, to enhance our 3D model, Denmark is very flat. Our highest peak is 170 meters. So you might wonder why we need DEM manipulation. But from our point of view, we do need it. I found this fun little table. It's the three highest peaks in Denmark. So you can see they are 170 meters. When I was a child, this table should be read from above. Møllehøj is the highest peak, but when I was a child, it was Ejerbavnehøj at the bottom that was. But it's only the highest if you include the 30-meter lookout tower. And equally, the Ydingskovhøj in the middle, it has this Bronze Age burial mound that make it it's the highest peak. But if you count that off, the top is the Møllehøj is the tallest. So you can actually walk to Møllehøj and with a shovel and make it number two instead if you just remove 9 centimeters of dirt. So it's a lot different than going around Vancouver and seeing the mountains. The purpose was our 3D city model. It's 3D models, you can spend a fortune on 3D models and you still won't have what you want. So we found a compromise. We have the buildings in 3D, but no textures yet, because that's one of the most expensive ways to spend money on a 3D model. So this is our 3D model in its current stage. We have the autophoto on the bottom, and we have the terrain model. And why we need to modify the terrain is because we have this highway that is being built through the city, and it's going through a lot of both the nature, industry areas, and residential areas. As you can see, it is a relatively curved terrain. It might not have mountains, but we need the highway to we need to show the real terrain after the highway is built. Such highway data we get from our national Department of Transportation, that they are those that build the highway. They use subcontractors, obviously, but they control the process. So they deliver to us such a CAD file. And this one looks okay from here, but they usually, I'll show you later that it has some surprises in it. And it's a 3D CAD file. So with FME, I can make it to a tin model with the DEM generator. There are multiple transformers that are a bit similar that can do translations to this. You need to do a lot of cleanup on the data, but FME is fairly good at making these tin models. From there, we go to a DEM raster. Here I have the original terrain model beneath our project data, and you can see the highway cutting through. In 5 years' time, a new terrain model would probably look the same, but here it's the project data yeah, cutting through the terrain. And we end up with a nice edited terrain. As you can see, the highway cuts through this hill, and it would look quite awful if we didn't make this terrain change. So it's very important to enhance our 3D model so it looks realistic. We use this for politicians and citizens who want to get a better view, like why is my house being demolished, and if it's not demolished, if it's on the edge, well, how much of the highway can I see from my house? These kind of things. Of course, we would like to have the forests in 3D, and that is also something we're working on. I'm trying an FME, but my boss is checking prices elsewhere because it's a very hard task. I have tried using the surface model, but we get all sorts of weird polygons. But there's a lot of FME can do a lot of this stuff if you have the right data. So I spend a lot of time with this, but it gives a much better expression with the terrain cut out. And another view at this. Then I have one of the funny examples of interesting CAD data, like here. We found this suddenly when doing our TIN model and found out, whoa, these guys don't really know the data quality. Or perhaps they don't work with these files themselves. Maybe it's an export from another program, but we had, of course, to get a new file. Because if this was a highway, you really had to hold on to a coffee and the glasses and everything. Also this one, we have the highway and an adjoining road, but suddenly the object called a terrain edge is 30 meters above the rest of the drawing. I don't know what happened here, but I hope it's not these drawings that they actually make the highway from. But that's some of the kind of funny surprises you get working with CAD files. Probably CAD guys would say the same about GIS. Then, almost to my pet project. In Denmark, we have a base map of buildings, rivers, roads, all sorts of feature types that form a background map. And this map is made through a subcontractor in China or Indonesia, where else the workforce is cheap. So we get data from China or elsewhere, and we have to do some quality control. And that is usually manual work that I hate. So I tried to use FME to do a little testing on our data. My workspace was fairly simple, just three transformers. But in my raster expression evaluator, I had this formula that tests if a pixel is red enough. In Denmark, a lot of buildings have red roofs because we use clay on top of our houses. Most buildings are made of clay or concrete. We don't have a lot of wood houses that I've seen you have in Vancouver. So I thought, if I at least can identify houses with red roofs, I would get an impression. I would get about half of our houses, I guess. So that might be worth a try. So I designed this if statement to select red pixels. Of course, I would also get there are other red things in an autophoto than buildings, but not so many other. If I wanted to search for black roofs, it would be much harder. So I started with red roofs. This workspace made this raster. The code you saw before just tests if a pixel is red enough or not red enough. And if it's red enough, it gets a white value. Otherwise, it gets a black value. So this map is where the pixels are the white pixels in this map is where the pixels are red enough. And if I put our photogrammetrically produced buildings on top, we see that, well, it's quite okay. I have some white lines up in the northeastern part, but oh yeah, and here's the autophoto I started with. But in northeastern corner, I have some buildings that have been, the autophoto has been taken from an angle, so they are a little they're not taken from directly from above, so there is a mismatch in my analysis here. But still, it's okay. The building polygon is where it should be. That's the most important thing. And here's another example. I might have found a house that should have been registered, but no. It's just a wastewater facility with a basin with reddish water. There's some funny false errors in this analysis. Also, tennis courts will prove to be a false positive. Down here, I might also have found a building, and yes, I have. So it can be used to find missing buildings. You will notice that we have a lot of red cars as well on the left side. All the square white rectangles are red cars. But I can filter those out by analyzing on area, because no cars are the size of a building, except maybe a Coca-Cola truck. I haven't encountered one of those. So this is my pet project, but it's very fun. There's a lot of potential in this. FME is not really used to do remote sensing, but it can be used to it. There might be other programs that are better for remote sensing, but if I can do some remote sensing in a program I already know and I already have purchased. I'm thinking of other ways to utilize this, but it's hard finding things that are not red or green, very green or very blue. All the nature colors will get very, very many false positives. And a little tips and tricks from my point of view. I use inspectors everywhere. In this horrible workspace, I have 31 inspectors, and always I disable most of them, but then I can see how many objects end here, and that gives me a way to, doing a workspace like this is very much trial and error, figuring out, oh, did this transformer work right or didn't it? Well, I can see on the inspectors just a number of objects. Sometimes I might enable them to see what actually ended up in this inspector, but most of the time I have a lot of inspectors disabled, especially on the feature merger. I use them to see how many passed and how many did not pass. Also on tester transformers. Obviously, I need some bookmarks here and annotations, and it was primarily to show a horrible example. Guess you have them as well. Spend time learning the transformers. My work with FME it's gotten more successful the more transformers I have learned. In the beginning, I was just converting from one format to another, started using one transformer, stared at all the other transformers and wondered what they were going to be used for. But now I have, I probably only know one of four transformers. I'm not sure. But I have a feeling about what many do, so I know where to look for answers when I need them. And use bookmarks. They are incredible to organize your workbenches when they grow large. And lastly, document workbenches. Because if I find a workspace, a workbench that I used half a year ago, I have, sometimes have no clue what I was doing back then. It can be very, it can take me a very long time to figure it out if I had, have an advanced workspace. Yes, that's it.
We have time just for a few questions here, so if anyone has a question. I'll ask a quick one. The when you were batching processes at the beginning of the of your presentation, what are you using in the back end to schedule those tasks in FME?
I use it's on a Windows server and use the schedule jobs in Windows because we don't have a FME server. I would like to have an excuse to ask my boss for it, but well, the scheduled jobs in Windows are quite good for this.
Okay, good. Does anyone else have any questions? No? Well, thank you very much.
Yes.
There you go.
I'm curious about your 3D buildings. Did you use FME at all for those generations, or was that contracted out?
They were contracted. I've tried to texturize them with FME, but my... Well, I ended up not having the pictures. I tried Street View and all sorts of, Microsoft has a service as well, but you have to do a lot of manual editing of the photos, so I didn't have the time to do that. But the buildings are contracted, yes.
With your grid that you made to extract the cadastral data, did you ever have to adjust the size once like parcels were subdivided because of the 1,000 parcel limitation?
No, I downloaded, if a parcel were on two grids, I downloaded both and then used a duplicate remover to remove the identical one. So.
There's no final questions?